Please welcome Emmanuel Jal. Welcome.
Wow.
You're in London with a movie that you act in a movie with Reese Witherspoon.
Yeah, I did a Hollywood thing, yeah.
Yes, and this was your first time being an actor. Did that give you more or less respect for actors?
Well, it's a different form of a therapy, but the life beyond it, when I was introduced into that world, the way I normally describe it is, I can't believe it, how I came from the bottom like a lobster, and now I'm rolling on the top like a rock star.
The thing is that what we saw here was you, and you were in this camp for refugees, and before that you had escaped from Sudan and from wartime Sudan. And let's start there. Tell me how did that war affect your family?
Well, the war robbed the core of my family, you know, it's robbed the soul in my village. The first time I witnessed war, I thought the world was ending, because I used to hear my mother telling me the world is going to end someday. And so, and seeing people running different direction, you know, you see animals even confused, big bombs dropping, ground shaking, like there's so much confusion. And I got used to seeing people die. I still even have the scars of the wars. The first time it happened, even my leg got burned. I fell, a bike fell on me and I was on fire. So the war reached the core of my family. So my aunties died during the war, including my mom. All my uncles later, when I get to hear more stories, were claimed by the war. And as things festered, and we keep running from one place to another, and then we had to walk to Ethiopia.
You had to walk to Ethiopia? That's a very long walk.
It was a long, because month, a lot of kids died on the way. Some died of starvation, crossing the rivers. They were beaten by hippopotamus. You know, hippopotamus don't eat, but they're very territorial. So when you cross the river, they're able to smash somebody into two. And crocodiles were eating them. Some who don't know how to swim get drowned.
Try to describe coming to Ethiopia, because after this very long journey, you came to Ethiopia, to this camp that it was UN controlled.
Yeah.
And this is the camp where we saw you, right?
Yes. So
what kind of camp was it? How was it?
It was, when I arrived there, there was joy, because finally we feel we made it into a safe place, you see. It was like a sea of children, 1,000, 30,000 or 40,000 young people, few adults. And what I found that was really depressing was kids asking questions, and simple questions like, who made the bag of maize? And if somebody is not able to answer that, where is my mom? Why did this happen? Because you're in a situation where you see 6, 7 years old burying their own dead. Somebody die, we make our own prayers, we dig our own grave.
There weren't any grown-ups there. There were nobody to take care of you.
There were few adults. And then also probably UN think they are controlling the camp, but actually it's the SPLA which was controlling the camp.
And the SPLA is the rebel soldiers?
Yes, the rebel soldiers.
These are the people that recruited you as a soldier yourself?
Well, what actually happened for me is, I saw a child soldier for the first time, you know, because I used to like talking a lot. It gets me in trouble, sometimes it opened doors for me. But here, I saw this little kid with a gun and I was talking to him, he punched me on my face, and I saw stars, I fell off. So instead of getting angry and fighting, I keep asking him and he keeps scaring me. I say, I want to be strong like him. So when they created an opportunity that they want to train us, I was really ready for it. Because if you look at it...
And this happened in the UN camp?
Yeah, just 2 hours or 1 hour to 2 hours away, there's a training military camp in the bush there. UN can't get there, but they only know the refugees situation. So half the population went for the first training. So even when the UN come, they see there's still children. Then those one who finish training come back. And I was excited to go for the training, but I hated it because we're so singing songs, we're so happy, and all of a sudden, these soldiers just come out of the bush and just beating everybody, just beating everybody. You drop your bag and running. And when this training started, the first thing I said, once I finish this training, the first person I want to kill is my trainer. So it was that bad. So I plan also to try to escape.
And what they do is that they teach you to fight, and they teach you, but they must also convince you that you want to kill, you want to fight, somehow.
It's hard to convince somebody who has experienced it. All the kids saw what happened to their village. Me, I wanted to revenge for my family. I had no idea what the war was for. So when I was trained, I hated Muslims and Arabs, and my idea was to kill as many Muslims and Arabs as possible.
And they're in the north, and you were in the south of Sudan, and that's what the
But war I no was longer about. Feel like that now. So that's my understanding.
How did you get out of this? I mean, you escaped this life, and that was hard as well.
It's hard to escape everything, because sometimes things come back. Like sometimes I may think about the battlefields and you feel you kind of like your body. I don't know if a car has ever missed you or something has ever almost killed you, and when you think about it and you panic a bit. So those little flashbacks, and or maybe losing an appetite. The worst things, like maybe the things that still come in my head, is when there's so many dead people. You know, after when you hear the cry, you see the bones, people who has been hurt sticking out, and you can actually feel their pain. When the guns are on, there's the rhythm that goes with it. But when they're off, when everything goes quiet, that silence, after the celebration of your victory, or when you've lost the battle, and that's the scare of it.
You eventually got out of it, escaped, ended up in Kenya first.
Yeah.
How did that change your perspective?
Well, I think I'm lucky, because when we did the final escape, we were like 200 to 400 young people, and only 16 people survived. It was the worst, the lowest point I've ever been, because I was tempted to eat my comrade. So one of my friends died, and I was tempted to eat them. But I finally got in a place called Wat, and here I met a British aid worker called Emma McCune, and she is the one who smuggled me to Kenya. So I was disarmed, and she brought me to Kenya and put me in school.
You got an education. You also became very interested in music.
Yeah.
Became a hip hop singer.
Yeah. So I think the talent discovered me instead of discovering it. Because I got to start rapping at the age of 20. So I was doing it for fun. I didn't know it was something that's gonna pay my bills later. And so now I use it for social emotional learning. So I perform in concert festivals, or I go to schools where I share my experiences and mix it with music. So music is the painkiller.
And I found it really exhausting and actually also a little bit stressful and scary. So I made a decision.